In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. O Lord, open thou my lips. Make haste, O God, to deliver me. Give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Sing to him, sing praises to him. Glory in his holy name. Seek the Lord and his strength. Remember the wondrous works that he has done. O offspring of Abraham, his servant, glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. O give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name. The Old Testament reading for the ninth Sunday after Pentecost is taken from Deuteronomy chapter 7. You are a people holy to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for his treasured possession out of all the peoples who are on the face of the earth. It was not because you were more in number than any other people that the Lord set his love on you and chose you, for you were the fewest of all peoples. But it is because the Lord loves you and is keeping the oath that he swore to your fathers, that the Lord has brought you out with his mighty hand and redeemed you from the house of slavery, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know therefore that the Lord your God is God and faithful God, who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and his commandments to a thousand generations. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us. The epistle is taken from Romans chapter 8. We know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised? Who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 13th chapter. Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who on finding one pearl of great value went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and gathered fish of every kind. When it was full, men drew it ashore and sat down and sorted the good into containers, but threw away the bad. So it will be at the close of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all these things?" They said to him, "Yes." And he said to them, "Therefore every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like a master of a house, who brings out of his treasure that what is new and what is old." But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. This morning we continue with Jesus' series of parables about the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven is like unto a sower who went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell along the path, etc. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while his men were sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds. And today, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a treasure hidden in a field, or a merchant in search of fine pearls. So what does our Lord Jesus have to tell us about the kingdom of heaven this morning? Now the third parable about the sorting of the fish is, it's controversial, but it's not controversial because it's hard to understand. It's one of those parables that is very clearly about the last judgment, and it is only controversial in that many people don't want to understand it, right? But on the other hand, the first two parables, there is valid debate. The parable about the treasure hidden in the field and the parable about the merchant in search of pearls. Now, broadly speaking, there are two ways in which these parables have been interpreted in the history of the church. And I don't think that we have to be overly dogmatic about which one is correct in this case. Parables, by their very nature, are somewhat obscure, right? Jesus earlier, in just this very chapter, tells us this very fact, and that this is precisely what he intends. And so the question we must always ask when setting out to interpret a parable that Christ has cast before us is whether or not our interpretation is in line with those plain and clear texts of Holy Scripture. Scripture interprets Scripture. And what is said obscurely in one place so that we might have the joy of meditating deeply on the mysteries of God is said plainly in another so that we might not be confused. And in this case, both common interpretations readily fit in with what Christ and the apostles say elsewhere. What they say very clearly elsewhere. And so no matter which way you go in the interpretation of these two parables, you're not in error. But while both interpretations are perfectly orthodox, I do think one interpretation is more glorious, at least in my estimation. And so the first interpretation, which is the one I do not favor, but is nonetheless the most dominant, takes these parables from a human perspective. It takes the parables from a view from below. Who is the man? Who is the merchant? Well, it's you. And what is the treasure? It's Jesus. He is the pearl of great price. He is the treasure which is the love and the grace of God, a treasure worth far more than all earthly wealth or glory and earthly life. The prevalence of this interpretation can be seen in the hymnody of the church, right? One of the hymns we've sung several times this year, I think, is Jesus, priceless treasure. And this is the way that St. Irenaeus, the great second century bishop of Lyon, understood this parable, and what Irenaeus says should never be brushed away lightly. Not to mention that St. Augustine and the blessed Dr. Luther also follow him. And so carrying on the imagery from the last couple of parables that we've heard these last 2 weeks, the field is the world. And in the incarnation, in Christ's assuming of human flesh, he has hidden himself in the world. In the incarnation, the seed of God, that word of God, has been planted in the field. And upon discovering him, the man, in his joy, goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. That is to say, that the believer, like Peter and Andrew, James and John, left their nets behind to follow Jesus, the believer finds Christ and through eyes of faith sees that he has discovered the treasure of unparalleled value. Indeed, the only treasure with eternal value. He has discovered the Messiah. He has discovered Jesus. He has discovered Jesus through whose blood is the forgiveness of sins, righteousness, peace with God, and eternal life. And in his great joy, he happily counts all as lost in comparison to this great gift. And this fits perfectly with what Jesus taught us at the beginning of the summer, that whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. That he who wishes to be a disciple of Jesus should count the costs, because with it may come persecution at the hands of men, enmity with the world, and even division within the family. Indeed, if you recall, our Lord Christ even went so far to say that whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. The cost of following Jesus may very well be everything, but nonetheless we heard about how his burden is light and his yoke easy. Now the danger that presents itself in this interpretation, if it is taken too far, is that it could make Christianity just like any other religion of the world. It could make it transactional, a religion of works. If read as law, we could understand it as saying, he who wishes to purchase the treasure of heaven must first sell all that he has to obtain it. But of course, to do this would be to misunderstand the parables. We'd be pushing the analogy too far. Analogies always fall apart at some point, right? If I say that my wife is like a rose, I mean that she is beautiful and delights my eyes like a rose, right? That just as a rose has a pleasant scent, her presence makes the atmosphere in the room pleasant. I do not mean that she grows in the dirt and is covered in thorns. There is a certain point in which, right, the analogy always falls apart. And so if we were to push the analogy too far, we'd be like those of whom Jesus says, this is why I speak to them in parables, because seeing they do not see, and hearing they do not hear, for they do, nor do they understand. And so in this we see the importance of the phrase, in his joy he goes and sells all that he has. The point of the parable, the point of comparison, is not the transaction, but the joy of the man that has in fact discovered the true treasure, right? The man who has discovered Christ and then happily gives up all he has for him. It is not about the transaction, but about the value of the treasure when compared with all else. And so, this is a fine interpretation, but it is not the interpretation that I prefer. For Jesus says, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field. The kingdom of heaven is like a merchant. The point of comparison is the kingdom of heaven. That is what he is describing. And here our English translation is perfectly correct, but is lacking a little bit of nuance. The Greek phrase that we translate as the kingdom of heaven is he basileia ton uranon. And the word for kingdom here is basileia. Now in English, when we hear the word kingdom, we think primarily in terms of static geography. A kingdom is a place, right? But in Greek, the word basileia, kingdom, is the noun form of the verb basileuo, which means to exercise authority, to rule over, to reign. Meaning that the word kingdom carries with it a certain dynamic character. It is not a static reality, but a dynamic reality. There is a verbal idea within the noun. We are not talking about a place, but we are talking about an activity. We are talking about God's reign. We are talking about God's activity and rule. And so perhaps we could better translate this verse as, heaven's reign is like a treasure hidden in the field, is like a merchant. And now if we are talking about the reign of God, about the activity of God, God's ruling of his kingdom, how does this change things? Who is the active agent? It's not you. It's God. And so the script flips. The field is still the world, but who is the man? Who is the merchant? It is our Lord Jesus Christ and his reign of grace. And what about the treasure and the pearl? What are they? Our Old Testament reading points us in the right direction. The Lord says to his people Israel, "You are a people holy to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for his treasured possession." Who is the treasure? Who is the pearl of great price? It is you. You are. You are the church, the new Israel. And it's not because of your brilliance, either in mind or in luster. It is not because of your moral perfection, but it is because God loves you. As God says of Israel, he says of you, it is because the Lord loves you. Indeed, as St. Paul says, he foreknew you and also predestined you to be conformed to the image of his Son. You are the pearl among the pearls, known by God from all eternity, predestined to be his. You are the treasure hidden in the field, lost in the world, and the Son of Man has come to seek and to save the lost. He is the merchant who has come down from heaven to find the pearl set aside by his Father for him and to purchase it. He is the man who has come into the field to find the treasure. And having found you, in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has. He purchases and wins you by his crucifixion, by his death, by his holy and precious blood. He gives all that he has, even his life, for you. The value of the pearl, the great price of the treasure, is the price of Christ's sacrifice. As the preacher to the Hebrews says, Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, for the joy set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame. Indeed, dearly beloved, you are the treasure. You are the pearl of great price, whom Jesus has come to find and whom Jesus has redeemed. And what then shall we say to these things? We can simply answer with St. Paul, if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave himself up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who can separate us from the love of Christ? Who can separate us from the merchant who sold all that he had to buy us, to win us, to redeem us? Nothing. We are his and he is ours. Thanks be to Jesus. Amen. The ushers may come forward to receive the offering.
depth of the canticle hymn. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, you have redeemed us out of your steadfast love. Grant that the gospel may go forth unhindered and your Spirit bring many into this fellowship of the redeemed. Bless especially the work of our missionaries, such as the Reverend David and his wife Barbara. Lord, in your mercy, Heavenly Father, you have revealed to us the true treasure of Christ's cross and resurrection. Grant that we may pursue your kingdom with all our hearts, souls, minds, and bodies. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Heavenly Father, you have given us various offices in our lives. Grant us faithfulness in these callings that we may see them as gifts through which we serve you and our neighbors. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, grant wisdom to Joseph, our president, Mike, our governor, and all who make, administer, and judge our laws, that they may seek what is best for all in accordance with your will. We also pray for those in our armed forces who guard and defend our country, especially Sean, Austin, Thomas, and Leah. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, bestow your comfort upon all who are burdened by sickness and affliction or are in need of healing, especially Amy, Harold, Pat, Carol, Jordan, Prabhu, Aubrey, Barbara, Charlotte, Maya, Wanda, Kenny, and Patricia. Grant that they may await healing and deliverance in the firm conviction that nothing can separate them from your love in Christ Jesus. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord God, Heavenly Father, it is not for the sake of our numbers or strength or birth that you preserve us, but for the sake of your faithfulness and steadfast love. As you preserved your ancient people Israel for the sake of your promise, keep your holy church on earth and also preserve our synod. We pray for the sake of your name. Lead our delegates and members gathered in convention according to your good pleasure and will, that in word and action we may love you and keep your commandments, confessing your steadfast love and faithfulness, even to a thousand generations, through Christ the Crucified, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord be with you. O Lord, our heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, who has safely brought us to the beginning of this day, defend us in the same with thy mighty power, and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our doings being ordered by thy governance may be righteous in thy sight. Through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end. Bless we the Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all. Thank you. For those of you who were in a Bible this morning and were looking for the hymn verse that I quoted for you today, that I said was coming up, it did not come up because apparently the LSB version of our hymn of the day actually has more verses than the TLH version, which is very rare. Usually it's the other way around. So that was absent from our hymn of the day. Still a great hymn, though. From God Not Divide Me. Couple of announcements. So next week we will not be having the divine service. We won't be having communion, even though it's the first of the month. And we moved it because of the Shum family reunion event that is that Sunday. So we'll be doing that the second Sunday of the month. So we'll be doing matins instead. So I guess that's most important for Altar Guild. Don't set up for communion next week. Wait another week after that. And on that note as well, I will be on vacation this week. Like I mentioned last week, my family, besides the baby, will be in California, and I will be here with the baby, which means if there are any emergencies, please do not hesitate to call. I will find someone, hopefully, that can watch Philly for a little bit if needs be, but otherwise, try not to get sick, but if you do, don't hesitate to call me this next week. And we will be having a seminarian filling in next week as well. Don't forget, if you signed up for either the Tin Caps game or the luncheon after the service next week, which I will be at the luncheon after the service, don't forget about those. Those are coming up if you RSVP'd for that. Mark your calendars for August 15th, the next Ladies' Aid, and as usual, let Natanya know if there is anything that needs to be in the bulletin, or I guess this week you can actually let me know, because I'll be doing the bulletin, and probably calling Natanya to ask her how to do it exactly, but but I'll be putting that together this week. Anything that I have missed? Okay, well, congratulations on surviving this last hot week, and I think it's going to be another warm one, so good luck. Depart in peace.